Thank you. It's wonderful to come in with the joyous sound of music and song and laughter and oops. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our time of celebration this day, and as we gather in from the many places we call home, many places there where we live and play and whatnot, and as we begin our week to come and celebrate and give thanks for the wonder and the beauty of the God that surrounds us in so many wonderful and surprising ways. To those who are worshiping through our Facebook Live, a warm welcome to you as well. And we certainly hope that you feel very much a part of our worship time this day. Yes. Oh, okay. Oh, Helena, I know that Helena and Brian wanted us to say, she wanted to pass on their good wishes and whatnot to the congregation, but they're watching also Facebook Live. So if you could stand up and turn around and give them a wave. There we go. And our thoughts are certainly with Helena and Brian, as Brian is having treatments in Halifax and whatnot, so certainly things are going well with them, and we are with them in prayer and in thought as they move down that journey. So it's good to have them with us this morning in worship. Also, I want to highlight some of the announcements in the bulletin as well. But first, I'd like to note the bulletins today are in loving memory of Betty Howitt and remembered by Central Queen's musical friends. So our thoughts are with the Howitt family and certainly with all those this day who experience any loss in their lives and that sense of separation. I haven't checked this morning, but I know the barometer is still rising back there. Obviously lots of extra change in people's pockets for the roof. So thank you for all who are giving to that that worthwhile cause. Also, just a note, we're not going to be here next Sunday because it's we'll be in worshiping in Charlottetown, to which all are invited at the university. The regional meetings take place there. But fund script the order will be put in again next week on May 28th. So Janet is well ready and willing and able to go and take your requests and whatnot for the fund script. Cecil, would you like to have a few words? Where's Cecil? Where's Cecil?
Just want to remind you again of our roast beef supper on June 17th. Excuse me. It's takeout. Lois Lesmanas has tickets and Debbie Ling has tickets. There should be a dessert list circulating, I think, today. We'll need people for coming up on Friday morning at 9:30 and Friday night at 6. And I'm in real need of workers, so please sign up when you're leaving today, because there's other things interfering with graduation at Bluefield, so we do need help. Anyway, if you could sign up, please, or know of somebody else, remind them to come and sign up, because we're not here next week, so that means we're missing the week of signing up. So anyway, think about it, and if you know someone, please refer them to me. Thank you.
Thank you, Cecil.
Add the dessert list.
Here we go.
I didn't tell Cecil, but the dessert list I haven't got going around this week, but I'll have it at the table after church if you wish to sign up.
And if you're looking for a ticket, then you have one contact person, that's Debbie, and her number's in the bulletin, and you must order in advance, so please note that. Also, we are still looking for a summer student. And so if you know of anybody that's interested, please have them reach out to us. We've not had, we're not getting very lucky in finding someone to share with us in the summer. So, also, Gina, do you want to say a few words regarding the yard sale on Saturday, July 8th at 8 to 12? Well, it's always you.
But anyway, I'm here again. Nice. Anyway, July 8th is the date of the yard sale this year, and it'll be from 8 until 12. And so if anybody has things to bring, please do. We know where to bring them now, or see Velda, and she'll let you in to put the stuff in. Anyway, we hope to raise as much money we did last year, which was over $2,000, or close to. So let's do it again. So there you go, July 8th, 8 till 12. And if you want to bring any baked goods or jars of jam, that's always appreciated as well, because it goes like that.
Something good to say? we're starting to receive stuff that's going into the area. So any of those valuables that you have at home that you're thinking that you want to get rid of, this is the time to do that. So. And we'll receive those. I think those are our... There's lots of other announcements in the bulletin. I trust that you will take time to read them and have a look at them and be about those. Are there any other announcements or celebrations or... I think Mark has something to say. He's a very modest guy. And it is it's a challenging course that academically and also experientially as well. So congratulations, Mark. That's good for you. Good on you. Are there any other? Yeah. Excellent. Well, happy anniversary to you and your daughter and her spouse. So, yeah. Any other?
I challenge myself to lose weight, and it's not happening. Challenge Christine to make my breakfast in the morning. That's not happening. So, I just want to point out some fact. Last week, we were 19 men up here. 4 men there, Harvey, Matthew Red, Sarah's little fellow, brought the Bible, Benny. Roland at the sound, thank you very much. So that makes 23 people who are here. Father's Day, June the 18th. Something the fun though. Last week we had three generations here. That's gonna be hard to beat. Trevor was here with Wade and Braden. So that was pretty cool. That's all my fact. Thank you.
Any other comments? They'll be full of music when they come back, I'm telling you. They'll be ready for singing on Father's Day. There was once a person who said really awesome things and did really exciting things. And people began to follow him. And then one day, someone said, asked him, "Who are you?" And what did he say? "I'm the light." And so this morning we gather in the presence, in the love, in the light of the God that Jesus knew, and the light that began at the beginning of time. May we feel that light and live into that light, giving expression to the light in the ways in which we love and care for each other and celebrate our God. Let us take just a few moments to hold that light close to us. To God. When we see white billowing clouds, but God is not too great to care for the lonely and destitute. God rules from a holy place. God sets people free. God causes abundant showers to fall. God is among us and blesses us. With open hearts and minds, we worship God. Our opening hymn, All hail the power of Jesus' name. What do you do with all that ball of crumpled emotion when meaning and purpose disappear? As the one you follow is taken and the love you have chased is torn away, what do you do when you are left alone? With Jesus, we share in this ancient prayer, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And at this time, we'll have our psalm reading.
The responsive reading is Psalm 68, verses 1 to 10, and 32 to 35, found in Voices United, 787. Arise, O God, and let your enemies be scattered. Let those who hate you flee before you. But let the righteous be glad and exult before you. Let them rejoice with exceedingly joy. Protector of the widows, O
God, in your holy dwelling. Lead the prisoners out of prosperity, but the rebels must live in wasteland. When you went out at the head of your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth quaked, the heavens poured down rain before you, God of Sinai, God of Israel. You sent down a generous rain. You refreshed your heritage when it languished. For your people found a home, which in your goodness you provided for the poor. God, dominions of the earth, praise the one who has dominion. Rise through the heavens, even the criminal heavens, the ones whose voice is the mighty thunder. Acknowledge the power that is God's, whose majesty is over Israel, whose strength is in the skies. You're awesome, O God, as you leave your sanctuary, bringing power and strength to your people. Blessed are you, God of Israel. Blessed are you.
Our next hymn is I'm Going to Shout, Shout, Shout. And we're going to sing verses 1 and 2. And then as we gather up front with my little friends, we'll have a time together up here, and then we'll sing the last verse of that I'm going to shout, shout. And for the first one, I'm going to invite you to stand if you're able, sing the first two verses, and then for the last verse, we can remain seated. Hang out for a while up here. Remove that. Your job, Olive, is to tell, make sure that I move this back out because I always forget. Don't I? Yeah, I do. come on a little closer. Well, good morning. How are we doing? Good? Did you have a good week? You did. Did you manage to talk to anyone last week? Did you talk to anyone last week? You did. How many people did you talk to? One, two, maybe three. 300, holy smokes. That's probably right. We talk to a lot of people, don't we? And how did you talk to people? Pardon? Exactly, with your voice. But are there other ways in which we sort of were able to, we can write notes back and forth. That's like talking, isn't it? It's hard, yeah, that's right, because you gotta write stuff. What's another way that we talk to people? Yeah. Sign language, that's another one, sign, do you know how to do sign language? Well, that's cool, you're right, that's right. And what were you gonna say? Text, that's right. I wondered, do you text? No. Anybody text out there? I suspect nobody texts. I bet you everybody, a lot of people text, right? Yeah, yeah. Yeah, so text, and what else can we do? What other ways? Telephone, that's right. You ever talk on telephone? Anybody? Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right. Telephone. That's pretty cool, too. And what's the other way that we can do it as well? Some people, I have a, my microphone, that's right. And I have a son who's out in, he's away from here. And every week, my wife and I, we call him up. But we don't only call him up.
Well, I know.
It's a
video call.
We do a video call. In Thailand, you did that back when, I think your grandmother and grandfather told me about that. Yeah, that the, yeah, so then you can see people face to face. So that's even cool as well. Yeah, what do you think, was that cool? Yeah, you bet. Okay, yeah. Don't know what you said, but it sounded good. Yeah, that's right, exactly. Well, you know what, it's important to well, talk to people and acknowledge people. Sometimes, like a smile is all that we needed to go. When you give someone a smile, especially. Well, sometimes you just, hi, how are you? Oh, just go like that, and then they, oh, okay. They might talk to you then. That's right. Well, you know what? Talking is important. Just imagine if you went throughout your day and you didn't talk to anyone. What would that be like? You got up in the morning and you went down to breakfast and nobody talked to anyone. Nobody asked you, well, what would you like for breakfast? Or you go to school or go to play or something, go visit a friend, you come back and nobody, you didn't say anything to anyone. I don't think you talk too much at all. That's right. And you know what? This morning, a little later on, and I think you're going to be out with Kim, and Kim's got some really awesome stuff. But this morning, a little later on, we're going to be talking, and it's about Jesus. And Jesus is going away. But he's saying a prayer. And you know what? Prayer is like talking to someone. Talking to God. You have your new shoes, you bet. And those look really awesome. I should get new shoes like that. Are they comfortable? Yeah, I bet they are. That's right. And you know, when we talk to God, it's sometimes we say, hi God, how are you? Sometimes we say, you know God, I'm really scared or I'm frightened or I'm afraid. And can you be with me? Sometimes we say, you know, can you be with my friend? Yeah. And can you be with someone I don't like? Or can you be with me to help me like people I don't like? So prayer doesn't have to be like this. Some people we see them praying like this. Sometimes it's just when we're going through our day, we say, hey God, this is an awesome day. Thank you. And so I think it's very important as we talk to friends and family and look at that new dress, wow, and it's got, is that, that must be Mickey Mouse.
Minnie Mouse.
Oh, I don't know, that looks like Mickey.
No, that's
Minnie Mouse. So let's have a prayer together. I like your dress, by the way, that looks cool. Hey God, thank you for Minnie Mouse. Thank you for new shoes. Thank you for laughter. Thank you for each other. Thank you for kindness. Thank you for talking. Never too much. Thank you, God, for being with us. We'll talk to you later. Thank you so very, very much this morning. And thank you for sharing your new shoes and your Minnie Mouse dress. Those are awesome. And I tell you, there's going to be something really awesome happen out back. I think there might even be, and and those, are those new socks as well? Those look pretty good. There's going to be some awesome, I think there's going to be treats out back. Whoa. So you're invited to go back out if you want, or you can hang out with us in here. but you're going to get some nice sweet treat to back, so. There we go. Okay. And we can sing our last verse. Take a look in the mirror, or to take a look at a picture, get a picture of yourself, go back when you were, I'll look around here, 20 years old. I don't think I'm safe. But yeah, 20 years old. And take a look at yourself now. You will realize that you've changed. And Mark can attest to this through the course that he's taken, that life is all about transformation and change, that reflective process, and finding those ways in which God has snuck into our lives and have warmed us and challenged us, and we have responded in ways, and we've been transformed, and our minds have grown, our hearts have grown, our spirits are wider and more accepting. Transformation is a part of life. And our call to transformation and new life is a way to recognize that, and also recognize that we still have a way to go. We never arrive. I'm always a little dubious of those who have arrived or claim they have. So I'd invite you to join with me in the prayer for transformation and new life. And after each stanza, let's take a little time just to pause and to allow those words, like rain on dry soil, just to soak in a little bit and allow us to feel that presence. Will you join with me? There were times, gracious God, when we are steadfast and firm in our faith, like trees planted by streams of water. There are times when we bend with the winds of popularity and whim, giving in to whatever attracts us, caring little for your way. Forgive us. Renew us with the refreshing winds of your Spirit. Make us new. Strengthen us to grow into your likeness, to bear good fruit, to be pleased with you. We pray in Christ's name. Let us receive the assurance of these prayers. And may unity, care, joy, and truth be the fruit we bear into the world in our lives as a transformed and transforming people. So let it be. Amen. This Sunday brings the season of Easter to a close. Next week is Pentecost Sunday. And yet we will continue to receive the blessings God pours out for us in Christ and in creation. For God is good. We offer to God our thanks for such goodness in our tithes and in our offerings. We give as we are able. We give as we are called. Your morning offering will now be presented.
Nourish us with food.
pray. Each of us is a fragile miracle, evidence of God's creative hands and amazing grace. We are each unique, unrepeatable gifts to the world. We are proof of God's love. And so we who are the gifts of creation now give gifts to our Creator, gifts brought in love. Amen. Thank you, Christine. Please be seated.
Good morning. My name is Vern Smitherum. This morning I will be reading from Acts 1, 6 to 14. So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers.
Let us continue to hear the word as it's given to us through John's Gospel, chapter 17. I'm reading verses 1 through 11. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and he said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave to me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave me, I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I come from you, and they have believed that you have sent me. I'm asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one." Amen.
This is one of Walter's favorite songs, and so I picked it for him. I don't see Walter. But he wasn't feeling well, so he stayed home today for our safety as well as his. Hope we don't screw up.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength, our hope, and our salvation. Amen. Every now and then I'll come across some quotes that sort of speak to me. And if you're following me on Facebook, sometimes I'll pop those up either on the church one or my own private Facebook and whatnot. And last week, I came across a quote by Mr. Rogers. Remember Mr. Rogers? Mr. Rogers, Neighborhood. It's a children's show some years back. And I want to quote you what he said. He said, "I'd like to give you all an invisible gift, a gift of silent minute to think about those who have helped you to become who you are today. Some of them may be here right now, some may be far away, some, like my astronomy professor, may even be in heaven. But wherever they are, if they've loved you, encouraged you, and wanted what was best in your life for you, they are right inside you. And I feel that you deserve quiet time on this special occasion to devote some thought to them. So let's just take a minute in honor of those that have cared about us all along the way, 1 minute silent. Whomever you've been thinking about, imagine how grateful they must be that during your silent times, you remember how important they are to you. It's not the honors and the prizes and the fancy outsides of life which ultimately nourish our souls. It's the knowing that we can be trusted, that we never have to fear the truth, that the bedrock of our lives from which we make our choices is very good stuff." Today, from both our scripture readings, we are reminded about the bedrock from which we have made our choices, very good stuff. Next week, we'll be celebrating, or we won't be here actually, we're going to be celebrating Pentecost Sunday in another venue. But Pentecost Sunday is often understood as the day the church was born, the beginning of the church. And it's interesting, Jesus is not around for that day. In the drama of Scripture, after 40 days post-resurrection, he's gone. He splits. He leaves. So today is often called Ascension Sunday. When the curtains open next week, the church is born, Jesus isn't there. It's almost like the baby's first steps when the parent lets go, or the child's first bike ride when you're going along and holding, and then that moment where you have the courage to let go and let that child continue on its way. It's hard for the parent or the person significant in that child's life to let go. But let go they do, let go they must. And the child learns to ride the bike. The child learns to live life. This is a hard moment for parents. And in my experience, letting go is hard, but it must happen. However, parenting is always and ever a journey of letting go, isn't it? From the very time that little person is thrust or removed from the mom, it is the beginning of a long journey of continuous letting go. Political parties, clergy, CEOs of companies would learn well from that, because oftentimes they don't let go well. As a clergy person, I've always thought and struggled with, when is it time to go? When you've been here for a while, in a congregation for a while. And my thinking has always been, it's far better to go when people say, "Greg, you're a great guy," then overstay your welcome where people are whispering, when is he going to go? Time for him to go. So in our story today, after just 40 days, Jesus takes his leave. And if I were Jesus, I would have been experiencing great concern because the disciples, that his closest friends that hung out with him, were told, really never seemed to get on to what he was talking about. Never really seemed to understand what he was doing. But like the parent letting go of that bicycle or the mother letting go at birth, there comes a time when we must let go. Maybe Jesus knew that truth so well. I wonder, the fact that Jesus leaves reveals what sort of movement he has in mind. I suspect Jesus does not want a community standing around admiring him or merely waiting for him to act, but rather a community that is active and present in the world, carrying out the work of healing and justice and proclaiming the dawn of God's joyous jubilee that is here with us. In the end, the ascension itself is meant to invite it and empower the church to be all the more down to earth, into the world, for the love of the world. Oftentimes, church committees, these committees, don't seem to embrace the invitation and the empowerment of the Spirit, and sometimes clergy don't seem to get that either. One of the committees that I have served for many years within the church is called Pastoral Relations Committee. Doesn't that sound like an interesting committee? Pastoral Relations. And one of the responsibilities of that committee is to help congregations find clergy that suit their community and communities that suit where the clergy person is, and to work and the work of the church in that particular location. And usually this is a fun and exciting time of anticipated change and growth for both the clergy and for the congregation, faith community. However, sometimes there are challenges when the congregation feels that they need someone to be in community with them as their minister, working with them, but they really need that minister to be the Messiah, to fix everything, to do everything, to dream everything, a leader that will take control and solve all the challenges. And this becomes even more challenging when you get a minister who likes to take control, who likes to have all the good ideas, who likes to take on the Messiah complex and to live out life that way. It never ends well. The church community, you see, is not about one person or one group of people. It's not about one denomination, one particular strain of religion. It's not about standing, gazing up in the heavens, waiting for the Messiah, waiting for some intervention to come in and fix things for us, and we can sit back and say, oh, that was good, you fixed it all. It is about being active and present in the world in ways that are accented by care, it's accented by a sense of respect for all. It is about being able to take the teachings and the understandings and the philosophical underpinnings of Jesus' teachings and making them real in our lives and in the life of the church and the world in which we live. It is about being open to good news that reaches beyond us and oftentimes surprises our thinking. It is about the invisible gift that Mr. Rogers wrote about, the Spirit that cannot be seen, but which is no doubt real and present, informing our lives, inspiring our lives, bringing to life the gift of community and the gift of God within that. It is about living in the present, dreaming about the future, not reminiscing all about the past. Jesus, in our reading, is passing on the mantle to you. to have a role to play in God's great story of redemption. You will now take the take on this new role. You will now descend from the Mount of Olives and enter the holy city. You shall proclaim the good news with your words, and especially with your lives. You, all of you, are commissioned and blessed and sent into the world for the love of the world. We take the dream. We live and move into that dream as we move into the future. What we've received, we pay forward. Next week will be Pentecost. And we will be reminded we are not alone, that the Spirit comes to us. The Spirit whirls around us. The Spirit inspires and moves us out into uncomfortable places. We are never alone as we move forward as a church, as a people of God. I'm going to ask that we take just a few moments right now before I begin our prayers of thanksgiving and intercession to hold a person or persons, to hold whatever is important to you in your mind, and to allow that to be your prayer. We don't need to say it out loud, but just bring to consciousness something that's really important and hold that as we share in prayer. Our life is prayer. We don't have to formally kneel and put our hands and gestures in any certain way. The whisper, the murmur, that sometimes we don't understand or even know, coming from the very depths of who we are as your creation, speak to you. And so, O God, as we hold in our thoughts and minds the persons, the places, the things, the events that are on our minds, whether those persons are in hospital, those persons are dealing with news that's not so great, whether we think of the war-torn countries, the fires out west, as we think about the struggles of people who are poor, if we think about our leaders who try to make and try to lead us in better ways, we might hold the church with all its wrinkles and with all its challenges, with all its shortcomings, but also with all its joy and with all the possibilities. Whatever is on our minds, whatever we hold right now, we offer to you, O God, these prayers. And we ask in your love and in your care, you might respond. So let it be. Amen. Our concluding hymn is, I am a child of God.
I am a child of God. I am a principle to creation. I am a child.
At this time, we extinguish the light, but notice as I extinguish. It takes on new form. It moves out. It's not still. It keeps moving. Among us, around us, going with us. And so may, as we go forth, feel that spirit that moves us, moves with us, is always with us. It's never single. It's everywhere. So go forth into the world, refreshed by the truth you have received from the Christ, and renewed by the knowledge that you belong to God. You have been chosen. Now go and choose life.